Thank you. Good morning. Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 24. Hear the word of the Lord. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek his face, O God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O you gates, be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we seek you as we enter into this time of worship. Purify our hearts and minds so that we may honor you with our praises and draw closer to you. May your Holy Spirit fill this place, guiding us and causing us to live according to your will. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please stand as we sing together. You may be seated. Once again, welcome to the First Chinese Church of Christ in Hawaii. We are so glad you chose to worship with us today. If this is your first time here, or if you are searching for a church home, we extend a warm welcome to you. We'd love to get to know you better, so please take a moment to fill out a visitor's card located in the pew and drop it in the koa bowl in the foyer. We also have a few announcements to share with you this morning. First, a big mahalo to Ling Hong He for providing the beautiful altar flowers today. Second, we invite you to join us right after worship to get in the gym for our monthly love feast. It's a wonderful time for fellowship, so we hope to see you all there. Next, for our seniors, the Forever Young Ministry is organizing a fun ride on the skyline on Friday, September 13th. We'll also be stopping for lunch at Don Quixote in Waipahu. If you can help drive or need a ride, meet at FCCC Church here at 9:30 a.m. Otherwise, meet us at Halava Station at 10 a.m. Remember to bring your Holo Holo card and be on time. You can sign up on the Ever Lanai today. Men, today at 11:45 a.m., we're planning meeting in the conference room during the love feast to discuss our upcoming men's Bible study breakfast. All are welcome to join and share your ideas. The 78th Annual Missions Food and Craft Fair 2024 Part 1 will be held on Saturday, October 5th. Part 2 will be on Sunday, October 27th, 2024. Co-chairs for these events are Debbie Lee Ki Wang and Jamie Simao. More information will be forthcoming. Lastly, we're excited to announce two midweek Bible studies for our English congregation starting this September. The first study is on Tuesdays at 9 a.m. beginning September 17th in the conference room. The second is on Friday starting September 13th with dinner at 6:45 p.m. and study at 7:30 p.m. in room 303. Both studies will cover the same material, so pick the one that works best for you. For more details on any of these announcements, please check your bulletin. Now I invite you to stand and greet your neighbor, share aloha with someone new today that you haven't spoken with in a while, and in a few moments, we will continue with our worship service.
Is that okay for you?
Return to your seats. We are going to continue to worship the Lord in song. I invite you to remain standing.
never ceases. His mercy never
Refiner's Fire. Everybody knows about this song, right? About gold, as we refine it, it gets more pure. And that's what the song is about ourselves, our heart being pure. From within and make me whole.
seated. This morning, we want to welcome Carl Bachman. He will be our new organist. So let's give him a hand as we welcome him this morning. Today, as we gather to worship, and as is our tradition on the first Sunday of the month, we will also celebrate the Lord's Supper today. This is when we remember Christ's atoning sacrifice, just as he has told us to do. As we approach the Lord's table, Scripture calls upon us to examine ourselves, to examine our hearts, our lives, in the light of the holiness of God. So I'm going to give you a few moments to come before the Lord and to pray, confessing your sins to God, asking him for forgiveness. After you take this time to examine your heart, I will pray for us as a congregation. So join me now as I pray. Almighty and most merciful Father, we come before you this morning. We are your people, and we acknowledge that we need you. We need your grace that only comes through Jesus Christ. Forgive us for our pride. Forgive us for our failure to love. We have not loved others as you have loved us. We have not been merciful people towards those who need mercy. Forgive us, God, for our words, for our actions that do not reflect the gospel. Forgive us for neglecting your word at home and in our lives, and for not living as people who have the hope of Jesus Christ in our hearts. Lord, our sins, they are so many, but your mercy is so much more. So Lord, we ask that you will purify us, take our sins, and give us your holiness through the blood of Jesus. Purify us through his blood, O Lord. Create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. Help us to walk in obedience to your will, living lives that honor the gospel. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Psalm 103:12 says this: as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Dear brothers, dear sisters in Christ, trust in God's promise today. Through the sacrifice of Jesus, all of your sins, the ones that you did this week, the ones that you did years ago, the ones that you have forgotten about, all of our sins in Christ Jesus are forgiven. Let us rejoice now as we continue to worship the Lord.
As we worship today, let us honor God with our tithes and offerings from the blessings he has given us. This Sunday, as on every first Sunday of the month, we will also collect a love offering to support those connected with First Chinese facing sudden hardships such as losing a loved one, a job, or dealing with serious health issues. Please designate love on your envelope if you would like to give. Ushers, please come forward to collect this morning's offering.
My peace I give unto you. It's a peace that the world cannot give. It's a peace that the world cannot understand. to you. My love I give unto you. It's a love that the world cannot give. It's a love that the world cannot understand. Love to know. Love to live. My love I give unto you.
My peace.
My peace I give unto you. It's a peace that the world cannot give. It's a peace that the world cannot understand. Peace to know. Peace to live. My peace I give unto you.
Father, we thank you for your abundant blessings in our lives. As we offer these gifts back to you, we pray that you would bless and multiply them for the work of your kingdom. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Good morning once again. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. We will be looking at Matthew chapter 5, verse 8. If you would like to follow along in a pew Bible, you can turn to page 1454. Let's read this passage as we continue our journey through the Beatitudes and as we make our way ever so slowly through the Sermon on the Mount. Let's read Matthew 5, 8, and then I'll pray. Hear now the word of the Lord. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. This is the word of the Lord. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Open our hearts to understand what it truly means to be pure in heart, so that we might see you. Guide us by your Holy Spirit, and transform us by your grace this morning. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. On Friday, me and Noah, we went surfing. We've been trying to learn how to surf, and it's been going terribly, but it has been going, and we're kind of sort of catching waves. We went down to Waikiki, and that's where we've been trying to surf at, and as we were walking out, we went and saw the ocean, and it was different than I'd ever seen it before. The water was clear, like perfectly clear. I'd always wondered why people were in that part of Waikiki snorkeling. I thought, there's no way there's any fish here. And I was wrong. There was fish everywhere. You could see them in the rock formations, and all of them, the beautiful colors and everything was right there. And it was an amazing sight. And it reminded me of those pictures you sometimes see when you're on Facebook or wherever, of those crystal clear lakes. Have you ever been to a crystal clear lake? The water is perfectly still, and it's like glass. And as you look out at the lake, you can see a stunning reflection of the sky above. As you look there at the water, the bright sun, the clouds are all reflected in that image. The birds soaring high are mirrored in that water with clarity as you look at that pristine surface. Now, that wasn't the way it was in Waikiki. But imagine that you're there. You're at that lake, that crystal clear lake, and you're seeing that. What would happen if that water was disturbed? What would happen if it was polluted? That perfect reflection would become distorted. It would become unclear. It would be ruined. Today we're talking about the heart. And our hearts are meant to reflect the glory of God. We're meant to be like that pristine lake that's reflecting the sky above. However, that's not how it is. When our hearts are clouded with sin, with hypocrisy, with divided loyalties, that reflection is muddled. It is ruined. Our hearts are ruined. We're no crystal clear lake. We're no easy to see ocean with tons of fish in it. We're just not naturally pure. We are, though, often divided. We're torn between our desires and between God's will. I mean, look at your heart. Consider it right now. You know I'm right. Our hearts are not in good shape. We're certainly not pure. Matthew 5:8, as we read, says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Like all the other Beatitudes, that's a gospel promise. And when we see the state of our heart in its ruined condition, it can make that promise that the pure in heart will see him. It can make it feel so unreachable. But here's the thing. A pure heart is not some goal that you reach or achieve or accomplish on your own. It is a gift. It is a gift from God himself. And in Matthew 5:8, Jesus is promising that those who have received this gift of a pure heart through the ongoing work of the Holy Spirit, those who have that, they will see God. They'll see him in the present, and they will see him in the future. Let's explore this verse and what it teaches. And we'll begin with our first point. What does it mean to be pure in heart? What does that mean? Does it refer to being free from sexual sin? Does it refer to being free from moral failure? I grew up in the day and age when purity was all the rage. We would take purity pledges. We would say we will not have sexual relations with anyone except for our wife. And we would say that before we ever had that wife. Teenagers would take that pledge. It was a part of the evangelical culture of the time. And I think when a lot of us hear the word pure, in our modern culture, in our modern Christian culture, that's what we think about. Being free from sexual sin. Being free from moral failure. Now, for those who heard Jesus say these words for the very first time, for those who were sitting there on the mount as he preached to them, that's probably not what they would have thought. A purity ring would have not popped into their heads. They likely would have thought about obeying the laws of Moses, obeying them perfectly. They may have thought about those purification rituals that they had to do before making a sacrifice. They may have even thought about the Jewish teachers and all of their extra rules that they had come up with. They would have thought about obeying these things, doing these things without fault. So does pure in heart mean that? Well, what does it mean? Let's turn to Scripture. First, let's consider the word heart. In Scripture, the heart isn't just about feelings. We often think that it is. My heart says this. I feel this way in my heart. But in Scripture, that's not the case. In Scripture, the heart is the center of our being. It encompasses our thoughts, our desires, our wills, and our feelings. The heart is who we are at the deepest level. When you read the word heart in Scripture, that's what should come to mind. Now, what about the word pure? The word pure in the Greek means clean. It means pure. No, it doesn't mean pure. It means clear. It means free from contamination. The word pure refers to something that is unmixed. It's untainted, both morally and ethically. So that's helpful, I think, if we take those two definitions and consider them when we think about the phrase pure in heart. But let's consider some specific passages of Scripture. Psalm 24, verses 3 through 4 asks this question: Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully. Psalm 24, 3 through 4 is telling us that to be pure in heart is to have integrity. It is to have sincerity. It is to be honest. It is to have all of these things before God and with God. It's about truthfulness before him. And then there's James 4:8. James 4:8 says, "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." Here, a pure heart involves an undivided devotion to God. It means being free from hypocrisy, from double-mindedness. To say it simpler, it means having a single-minded commitment to the Lord. So when we put all of this together, the James passage, Psalms, pure, the meaning of heart, what does it mean? Well, is it about freedom from sexual sin or moral failure? Yeah, that's a part of it. Is it about performing the laws of Moses perfectly? Yeah, that's there too. Is it about following the rules of those Jewish teachers perfectly? Yes, as long as those rules aligned with God's word. But it's more than just these things. To be pure in heart means to have this unwavering dedication to God. It's about having a heart that has no room for sin, no room for deceit, no room for divided loyalties, because your heart is so pure that it is fully focused on God and on his holiness. It's about a love for him, free from distractions, free from moral compromises. To put it simply, a pure heart is one that is devoted to Jesus. That's what it means when we see it in Scripture. And that means we got to ask, is that me? Is that you? Is that your heart today? Does that describe your heart? Is your heart fully devoted to God alone? I have an iPhone. Now, I know that not everyone will agree, but iPhones are the best phones. They are. If you have a Galaxy phone, an Android phone, I feel sorry for you. You're missing out on the very, very best phone. My iPhone is sleek. It's beautifully designed. It has a bright screen, a clear screen. It even makes everything look so sharp and vibrant. The camera captures photos and videos with great detail, showing everything in its purest form. But here's the thing. I have this problem. I don't have a case for my phone. And without a case, my perfect phone is vulnerable to damage. Have you ever dropped an iPhone before? Have you ever seen that happen? One bad drop and that iPhone is going to shatter. And when that happens, what was once a clear display, what was once a phone that could take beautiful pictures, can become hard to see, impossible to use, a broken disaster. Our hearts are like a smartphone that's been dropped on the ground and shattered. Do you believe that? Is your heart like that iPhone? It is. Except it's far worse than that. And it's far more costly to fix. James 17:9 tells us about our hearts. Jeremiah 17:9 tells us about our hearts. Jeremiah 17:9 states that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? We all know what the world says. Follow your heart. It says, listen to your heart. Do what your heart wants. That's the advice we hear at the end of movies, in the middle of shows. But Scripture says, no. Don't do that. The Bible tells us that our heart is divided. It's not devoted to God. The heart is filled with sin, with hypocrisy. The heart worships things it shouldn't. It's sick. The heart is full of deceit. Don't listen to your heart. A heart in this state, like a shattered iPhone, is a broken disaster that is impossible to use. So what do we need? We need pure hearts. We need new hearts. And without this, we will never stand in the presence of God. We will never be able to call him friend. We will never, ever see him. So how can I get a pure heart, a new heart? Let's consider our next point. And this is where the gospel comes in, the good news of Jesus. You see, God knows that your heart is broken. He knows that it is beyond repair, and he knows that you can't fix it. So what does God do? In Ezekiel 36, he proclaims that he will give us new hearts. In Ezekiel 36, verse 26, he says, I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And how much does this cost us? What does it cost to get this new heart? Buying a new iPhone costs money. Getting an iPhone fixed usually costs money. How much is this new heart going to cost you? The answer is nothing. It costs you nothing, nothing at all, but it came at the highest price for God. It cost him his son. On the cross, Jesus paid the ultimate price to fix what we had shattered. He took our deceitful, sin-stained, impure hearts upon himself, and he bore the punishment that you deserved. He gave his life for you in your place so that those who trust in him might receive the new heart promised in Ezekiel 36, so that you might receive a new heart, a pure heart, a clean heart. And that's what happens. When you place your faith in Jesus Christ, you receive his righteousness, his purity, his holiness. God no longer sees you in your sin. Sometimes you see yourself in your sin, right? You go, I can't believe I did that so many years ago. What's wrong with me? I can't believe I said that to my wife. What's wrong with me? I can't believe I did that thing. But God no longer sees you in your sin. He sees you in Christ. And if you are in Christ, then in God's eyes, you are righteous, you are pure, you have a new heart. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, for our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's your status. That's who you are in Christ. You are someone with a pure heart, a new heart, given freely by God himself through the costly sacrifice of Jesus. When the Hubble telescope was first launched into space in 1990, scientists were disappointed. The images were blurry. Upon investigation, they discovered that a mirror inside the telescope had this tiny, tiny flaw. And that tiny, tiny flaw was causing this distortion. Despite the vast distance the telescope had traveled, NASA, well, they came up with a solution. They developed a corrective optics system that would fix this problem. So they sent astronauts. They sent astronauts on a repair mission to fix the Hubble telescope. And that's what they did. Once the flaw was corrected, once the solution was implemented, this telescope began to provide clear pictures. Pictures of distant stars, of distant galaxies, of things that had never, ever been seen before by the human eye. Our hearts are like that telescope. They're flawed. They're distorted. Flawed and distorted by sin. But God came up with a solution. A solution to fix that problem. He sent Jesus, the solution, to do the work. And when we place our faith in Christ, God, through his grace, corrects our flawed hearts. He makes us pure before him. We are fixed, and we have what we need, not so that we can see the stars, but we have what we need so that we can see God himself. So how can you fix your heart? I told you the answer already. You can't. If you're going to trust in your own efforts to achieve purity, it's not going to happen. Instead, we must trust in Jesus. He is God's solution. So are you trusting in him? Are you believing in Christ? If you are, you have a pure heart. This is your identity. And it's not dependent upon your feelings or your actions, but on the work of God. And that brings us to our third point, the process of purity. While we are pure in Christ, and that is who you are, that is your identity, God also works on us through the Holy Spirit to make us practically pure in our hearts right now in our daily lives. Because you know, yes, God declares you pure, he looks at you as pure, but still you sin, still you run after idols, still you aren't as kind as you should be. You're more of a gossiper than you ought to be. So the Holy Spirit comes inside of you, and he makes you more and more pure. He helps you live more and more according to your identity. If you're a Christian, the Holy Spirit is inside of you. He's working on you. He's refining you. He's purifying you. He's making you more like Jesus. That's his work. That's what he's doing. Philippians 1:6 assures us of this process. He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. I wonder, how much do you know about gold? When I was a kid, I went to Italy, and they showed us this place where all this gold was sold. And I thought, Mom, Maybe we could get some gold for me. She said, no. I don't know too much about gold, but did you know that gold in its natural state has various impurities in it? And I don't know how it's done today, but to purify gold in ancient times, a goldsmith would heat the gold in a furnace until it melted. And this would cause the impurities to rise up to the top of the surface of the gold. And the goldsmith would skim the impurities off the top, leaving behind pure gold. And he would do it over and over and over again until he had the purest gold possible. How did he know when he was done? It was when he could see his reflection in the molten metal. When he could see his reflection in that melted gold, the process was considered complete. And our hearts are like that. And God is like that. The Holy Spirit is actively purifying you. He's removing the impurities that cause your heart to be clouded. He's causing you to reflect His image more and more each day. When we struggle with impure thoughts, it is the Holy Spirit who convicts us, empowering us to resist temptation and aligning our hearts with God's standards. When we're tempted to gossip or speak harshly, the Holy Spirit is nudging us to choose grace, to choose love, to choose honesty. When times are hard, it is the Spirit who is patiently making us more humble. He's there helping us to forgive. He's there causing us to be more refined through every trial. Your job, church, is to yield to that process. To not resist, but to run towards Jesus so that He can make you more pure. So are you doing that? Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to refine your heart? Or are you resisting His work? Don't resist. Go to God. And what does James say? He'll go to you. And as you draw closer to Him and He draws closer to you, He will make you more and more like His Son. Be with Him and you'll become more like Him. Let's consider our last point, the promise of purity. How does Matthew 5:8 end? It ends by saying, "For they shall see God." That's the promise that is here. And what does that mean? What does it mean to see God? In Scripture, to see God was to be in His presence. It is to experience His glory. It is to know Him intimately. In the Old Testament, seeing God was considered, well, impossible, especially for sinful man. When Moses asked to see God's glory in Exodus 33:20, God said, "You cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live." You see, the fullness of God's glory was too overwhelming for sinful humanity. Yet through Jesus, we're granted access to God in a way that was never possible before. Jesus tells His disciples in John 14:9, "Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." And it is through our relationship with Jesus we begin to see God more and more clearly. We begin to understand His character. We experience His love as we walk in His ways. So what I want you to see is that this promise to see God, it is being fulfilled right now in your life. We experience glimpses of God's presence and His glory through our relationship with Christ. We see it in this room. We see it at home when we study His word. We see it in the car as we sing His praises. But there's a future fulfillment too. There's a future fulfillment of this promise waiting for us. Revelation 22 verse 4 tells us about it. "They will see His face, and his name will be on their foreheads. That's your future. Those who are pure in heart, cleansed by Christ, will one day stand in the very presence of God, and we'll see him face to face. When I picture God, it's clouded. For whatever reason, I see a throne, and like he's sitting there, and it's clouded. That's how I see it in my head. But one day it won't be like that. You and me will stand before his throne, and we will see him clearly in all of his glory, purified by Christ, wearing the righteous robes that he has given us. Louis Zamperini served in World War II, and he endured just incredible trials during this time. After 47 days on a raft in the Pacific Ocean, he was captured by the Japanese Navy. And then he spent over 2 years in a brutal prison camp. What do you think that must have been like for his wife? His wife, Cynthia, what do you think that must have been like for her? Separated by thousands of miles, separated by the horrors of war, she was in this constant state of uncertainty. She didn't know if her husband was alive or if he was dead. And for much of that time, she clung to the hope of one day being reunited with Lewis. And she held onto the letters they had shared. She held onto those memories. And she longed and longed and longed for that day when she would see him again. Now, eventually, that war ended, and Lewis was released from captivity. Imagine the emotions that Cynthia must have felt on that day. On that day, as she anxiously awaited his return. On that day, as she hoped that he would come through the door. And that day, it came. It came that day when they saw each other face to face. Lewis later described it in his memoir. He wrote, "Cynthia threw her arms around my neck, and I held her like I was never, ever going to let go. All the pain, all the worry, all the fear, it disappeared in that instant. I was home." That moment had to have been a moment filled with tears, with laughter, with a deep sense of fulfillment as they embraced each other after so long. Do you long to see God that way? Do you long to see him face to face? I think you should, especially if you know him as Savior. Because one day you will see him face to face. And the pain that you're experiencing, the worry that you have, the fears, they'll all be gone. There will be a day when we will stand before him. There will be a day when we see his smile. There will be a day when we experience his warm embrace. Church, that day is coming. That's your future. Long for that day. Come quickly, Lord. Long for that day. And until then, we can see him. Just like Cynthia held onto the memories and letters, we're invited to seek God through his letter to us. We're invited to see him in his word. We're invited to talk to him through prayer. We're invited to worship him together as we wait for that day. So do that. Seek him now. He can be found. And if you seek him now, you will find him. One more story. It's another NASA story. During the 1960s, NASA faced this challenge of navigating the vastness of space with precision, with accuracy. If they wanted to send astronauts to the moon, and they wanted to send astronauts to the moon, then this was a challenge that they had to overcome. So they relied on what is called star sightings in order to accomplish this. Astronauts would use a sextant to take measurements of the stars to determine their exact position and the trajectory that they needed to head in. Without a clear view of the stars, they would become lost in space. Life can be chaotic. It can be full of distractions, of trials, of temptations, of sin. And just like those astronauts needed to keep their eyes on those stars, we need to fix our eyes on God. And because of the work of Jesus, we can do that. We can see him. We can know his will. We can do what he wants us to do. Jesus said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." A pure heart is one that is focused on him. It is one that is focused on him in every situation. So, church, I end by telling you this. You have a pure heart. Keep your eyes on God, and you can see him now, and one day you will see him face to face. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your work, on the cross through Jesus. We thank you that he gives us pure hearts. Lord, as the Holy Spirit works inside of us, sanctify us. Sanctify us through him, making us more and more pure, more and more like your Son. And God, may each day we seek you. May each day we seek you in your word, in prayer, in song. And God, help us to trust in your promise that one day we will stand before you and see you face to face. Lord, if there's anyone in this room who doesn't have a pure heart, who doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, I pray, God, that right now they will turn to you, that they will walk away from your sins, from their sins, and that they will run to Christ. And God, we believe what your word says. You will give them a pure heart. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we sing together. We gather around the Lord's table to take the sacrament of communion. Join me as I pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you to say thank you. We thank you for the cross. It shows us our unworthiness and our worth. On that cross, you, Jesus, atoned for our sins. You took our punishment. You rose again on the third day. Thank you, O God. Thank you, Jesus. As we now take the Lord's Supper together, we pray that you will remind us and help us to remember what you have done. Bless these elements and use them as a means of grace to our souls. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Having examined ourselves and confessed our sins before God, I invite you to partake in communion. If you are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and you have been baptized in his name, let's come forward now, and afterwards we will take communion together. So hold on to the cup and the juice, and we will all join in taking the Lord's Supper. Let's sing as we come forward.
He became sin that knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom of Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom of Jesus Messiah, Lord. heart of all. Lord of all.
At which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said to his disciples, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us do that. Scripture also says that in the same manner, Jesus took the cup, and having given thanks, he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for the many for the remission of sins. Drink from it, all of you." Let us do likewise. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the body and for the blood of Jesus poured out for us. Thank you for this reminder of your love, of your grace, of your compassion. Thank you for the reminder of the agony that Jesus endured and of the redemption that he won. Because of his sacrifice, all who believe are your beloved children, forgiven and redeemed through faith in Christ. May that thought never leave our minds. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing the doxology together. Let us bow to receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated.
We are one.